Hi everyone. In this lesson, we will talk about the force of friction. First, there are two types of friction forces. One of them is the static friction force. Second one is the kinetic friction force. First, we will talk about the static friction force. Assume that an object is lying on a horizontal surface, just like this object in here. It's lying on a horizontal surface. We know that two forces will act on this object. One of them is this object will be in interaction with the Earth, so Earth will be pulling this object downward, so gravitational force will be acting from the center of this object to the downward Fg. And second one is this object is in contact with the surface. That's why there's an interaction between the object and the surface, and this surface will be pushing the object upward direction, which is known as normal force. Normal force exerted by the table, Fm. So these are two basic forces if an object is located on a horizontal surface. And Fg is the gravitational force, Fn is the normal force by the surface. Both force will be perpendicular to this surface. So what if we pull this object in to the right? If an object is pulled with a force to the right, with a force F, you are going to observe that if this force is not great enough, this object will not start skidding. But according to Newton's first law, if an object stays at rest, which means net force acting on the object must be equal to zero. Fn and Fg cancel because they are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. But we need a fourth force which can keep this object at rest, because right now, according to this drawing, there is just one single force to the right. So if there is just one single force to the right, so this object cannot stay at rest. But if still this something is keeping this object at rest, there must be a resistive force in the opposite direction of F. So there must be a resistive force in the opposite direction of the F, which can cancel F and keep this object at rest. That resistive force is known as force of static friction and represented by Fs. And this static friction force is the because of the contact between the object and the table in here. So if this object is still at rest, then I can conclude that this F and that Fs must be equal in magnitude, so they will cancel. Net force acting on the object will be equal to zero, and this object will stay at rest. So this static friction force is always parallel to the contact surface. Now, contact surface is in horizontal, yes. So that's why static friction force will be parallel to the contact surface, and always will act in the opposite direction of the tendency of the skidding. This F try to skid this object to the right, so that's why static friction force must be to the left. That's why it will act always in the opposite direction of the tendency of the skidding, because tendency of the skidding is to the right in here, so this static friction force must be to the left. And always equal to the applied force in magnitude. What does it mean? So if it is at rest, if the velocity is zero, if this object is not moving, so according to Newton's first law, F and Fs must be equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, so their sum is going to be zero. But this equal to the applied force in magnitude is need a little details talking. If force applied on an object increased, if you apply a greater force on the object, static friction force also proportionally increases. And this prevents the object from skidding. If the applied force is small, if you apply a small force, and static friction force becomes small, and then their magnitudes are equal, so again, net force zero, object stay at rest. So no motion. If you increase the force, increase F, static friction itself also increases. So again, their magnitudes are equal, so net force zero, again at rest. Or if you don't pull this object, if you don't pull with a force, static friction, because F is zero, no applied force, static friction becomes zero. F applied force and static friction force proportionally increases as the F applied increases. So if F applied is, say that,
5 Newton, static friction force becomes 5 Newton. Say that if applied becomes 10 Newton, static friction force becomes 10 Newton. If applied becomes 15 Newton, static friction force becomes 15 Newton. So their sum becomes 0 because they are in opposite direction. Object stays at rest. So if we draw a graph, we will see that this graph is representing how applied force, external force by your hand, and static friction force between the object and the surface is changing. And because this is 5 and 5, 10 and 10, 15 and 15, that angle always is going to be 45 degrees. But static friction force can respond to the applied force not infinitely. I mean, it can respond to 5 Newton applied force to 5, 10 Newton applied force to 10, 15 Newton to 15, but it can respond to just a specific value. And static friction force can get a maximum value. So we can calculate this maximum value. Static friction force can respond applied force to some extent, not infinitely, so it increases until a maximum value. We will represent this maximum value as Fs maximum. If applied force is equal to that maximum value of the static friction force, object is still at rest but is about to move. Yani if you apply a little greater force than this value, say that maximum value is 10 Newton, so you apply 10 Newton, so it is ready to move. As soon as you make this 11 Newton, so object will start moving, will start accelerating. This maximum value of the static friction force can be calculated. So this maximum value of the static friction force depends on, first, composition and quality of the surface which are in contact. Second one is, it depends on the normal force. How big is this normal force is? How big is the action-reaction force between these two surfaces? So static friction force maximum value also becomes greater. So equation for calculating the maximum value of static friction force is mu s multiplied by Fn. In here is the mu s, which is coming from the composition of and qualities of the surface, yani type of the surface. It depends on type of the surface. It's just a number like 0.5, 1.5. So when the roughness increases, this number will increase. And also depends on the normal force, which is action-reaction forces between the object and the surface. And as I said, mu s is called coefficient of static friction. It's a constant number depending on the types of the surface, and Fn is the normal force or action reaction force between two surfaces. But when applied force, this F applied force, as I said, exceeds this maximum value of the static friction force, object will start moving. So object will start moving. Object will start accelerating. So if F is greater than Fs max, then object will start skidding. Friction between these two surfaces cannot stop the object, cannot prevent this object from moving anymore. And static friction force is important because static friction force helps object to set into motion. For example, an automobile tire can roll without skidding by contribution of static friction force. So there is a static friction force between the tire and the rod. As this tire is spinning, this tire pushes the rod back and applies a force on the rod. This is action force. So tire applies a force by using friction between the rod and the tire, and this force pushes the ground to the rod backward. So this is action force, and we know that every action has a reaction. So if action is on the rod, reaction must be on the tire. So this is the reaction force. This reaction force on the tire causes this car to displace. Static friction force, in fact, the cause of a motion. If there is no static friction force between the surface and the tire, in this case, this car cannot displace. It will start spinning on ice. For example, think about an ice. When the car is staying on an ice, even if the tire is spinning, so car cannot displace because it starts skidding. That's why every object can start rolling by static friction force. And static friction force, help object roll. So if there is no static friction force, object and no object can roll on a surface, they will skid, but they will not roll. That's why rolling starts with static friction force between the objects and the surface on which the object is rolling. Okay, this is the static friction force, but when the object starts skating, so we know that when the applied force on the object exceeds the maximum value of the static friction force, we said that object will begin to move with an acceleration. Object will start skating on that surface. So this is the table. This is the object. Because F is greater than Fs max, so there will be a net force in positive x direction. This net force in positive n direction will cause this object to start skidding on that surface. But still a frictional force will exist while an object is skidding on a surface. A retarding force will be again exist. That frictional force is called kinetic friction. Kinetic is used as a word if something is moving. As you see, the object starts to moving. That's why we use the word kinetic for this friction. Still, a friction force exists between the two surfaces, but because object is starting to skid, because object start to move, so that friction force is named as kinetic friction force and represented by F sub k. This kinetic friction force, first, acting on both surfaces while objects are sliding over each other. Kinetic friction force acts also in pairs, just like static friction force. It will be in opposite direction of the relative motion of the surface and acts on both surfaces as pairs. For example, here, assume that this above object is skidding to the right. So if above object on the table is skidding to the right, the below object, yani below surface, is relative to the above one, will be skidding to the left, relative motion. If one of them is going to the right, which means if you use this object as the frame of reference, so below object will appear to be moving to left. So we said that it acts on both objects. So this this force is always in the opposite direction of the relative motion of the surface. This surface is moving to the right. That is why, static kinetic friction force for that surface will be to the left. But the surface below, the object below, appears to be moving to the left relative to the above one. That's why that kinetic friction force will also act the below surface, but in the opposite direction of its motion. So as you see, they act as pairs. Their magnitudes are equal, as you see Fk and Fk prime, I wrote them, and their directions are opposite. They are acting on different objects. These are action-reaction pairs as well. Remember, Newton's third law said that in the nature, single isolated force does not exist. All forces exist in pairs. So this is Fk, kinetic friction acting on the above object, and also there's a kinetic friction acting on the below object, and they are opposite in directions, equal in magnitudes. And this force, this kinetic friction force, because it's acting in the opposite direction of the motion, it causes object to slow down. And this kinetic friction force causes this object to slow down, finally, in the end, causes object to stop. And its magnitude is constant. Remember, static friction force was changing from zero to a maximum value depending on how big is the applied force is. But in here, we don't have applied force. We have only the motion. And this kinetic friction force will be constant. It will be calculated by the same equation, but slightly less than Fs max, and it's maximum value of the static friction. This was the maximum value of the static friction. This was the applied force. Assume that this is 10 newton. That must be 10 newton. But If it becomes 11, if the applied force becomes 11, so object starts skidding. That's why kinetic friction force starts acting on this object. But kinetic friction is a bit less than static friction. So it will be just below the maximum value of static friction. Maybe like something not 10, maybe 8 Newton or something like this. But always will be less than the maximum value of the static friction. So, and it will be constant, its number is constant. That's why the same equation will be used for calculating the kinetic friction, force of kinetic friction, mu k multiplied by Fn. This mu k is known as coefficient of kinetic friction. It's again constant depending on the types of the surface. And this friction force, both kinetic and friction force, rises from the complex interaction between conducting surface. Even the surface seems to be very smooth. Microscopic level, at microscopic level, you are going to see that in fact they are rough. So this seems to be smooth surface, but when you look at this part by microscope, you are going to see that this surface is just in contact some points, not always in contact, some points are in contact. As these surfaces are relatively moving, these are like teeth. They stops, they prevents the motion of one surface relative to other one. So they are in contact at only these a few points. When surfaces are skidding, those points retards the motion and causes force of friction. Reason of the force of friction is this. In fact, it's even if you with naked eye you can see a surface to be flat, but microscopically they are not flat. They are always they are rough. That's why force of friction appears between the contact points of these surfaces. And static friction force and kinetic friction force both depends on, according to the equation, for example, maximum value of the static friction force, mu s multiplied by Fn, and kinetic friction force is always constant, which is mu k times Fn. Fn is constant, remember, it depends on the action-reaction forces between the surfaces, but mu Fs and Fk, they are a bit different. Fk is slightly smaller than Fs max. Reason is that because mu k, which is the coefficient of static friction between two surfaces, slightly less than coefficient of static friction between these two surfaces. For example, if you put one object still on another still surface, coefficient of static friction between these two surfaces is 0.74, but kinetic friction coefficient is 0.57, a little less as you see. This one is greater than that. Or if you put an aluminum object on a steel surface, so static coefficient of static friction is 0.61, but kinetic friction is slightly less than that, 0.47. Static friction force will be always a little greater than the kinetic friction force, or maximum value of the static friction force will be always a little greater than the kinetic friction force. A resistance is also a form of friction. Whenever an object moves through a fluid medium, it can be a gas or it can be a liquid. The fluid also provides a resistance to the object's motion, and it is called air resistance. This air resistance is also in the opposite direction of the motion of the object. As the object is, for example, this man is jumping, so velocity direction is down. So air resistance applies a force in upward direction. And also there is a relative motion between the object and its environment. So the object is the man is moving, so environment is air, so there is relatively air and the man in motion. And so air resistance is also a kind of friction. And air resistance increases with increasing area of the object, for example, in this parachuting. So that's why they are using such a large area, because when the area perpendicular to velocity is increasing, so air resistance also increases, so directly proportional to area of the object. And also air resistance increases with increasing speed. As the object speed increases, resistance of air resistance also increases. And liquids have a greater resistance than the gases. For example, assume that you are running in a medium which there is only air, so running is not so hard. But when you enter inside a liquid like seawater or the swimming pool, so it's not so easy to run inside them because resistance of the liquid will be greater than the resistance of the gases. And while an object is falling down, initially only one force acts, which is the gravitational force. So when an object falls freely through air, it accelerates and the free fall acceleration will act on it. However, we know that as velocity of the object increases, so there appears air resistance, and this air resistance will be in the opposite direction of the motion, and the motion of the object is downward, so air resistance will be upward, so it will be in the opposite direction of the gravitational force. And this will cause that object will experience a smaller resultant force. That's why object's acceleration will be smaller than the free fall acceleration, but still object will increase its speed. Finally, the velocity increases such a value that the oppositely directed air resistance force will be equal to the gravitational force. In this case, net force acting on the object will be equal to zero. And we know that if net force acting on the object is equal to zero, there are two cases. So object will stay at rest. If it is initially at rest, it will continue moving with constant velocity if it is initially in motion. Because this object in air is initially in motion, it will continue moving downward with a constant velocity, constant speed, which is known as terminal speed. Net force becomes zero, then object will continue falling down with that terminal speed, with that constant speed, which is known as terminal speed. And we will solve just one problem about the friction force, practice problem 3C, question number 2. Then we are going to finish the lesson. A 25 kilogram chair initially at rest on a horizontal floor requires a 165 Newton horizontal force to set it into motion. Once the air is in motion, a 127 Newton horizontal force keeps it moving at constant velocity. Find the coefficient of static friction between the chair and the floor, and also find the coefficient of kinetic friction between chair and the floor. And the mass is given 25 kilogram. The first force when it is at rest, so initially we applied a force which is 165 Newton. So this force causes object to into motion. However, to continue the motion, you should slightly decrease the force. So a force 127 Newton is needed to keep this object moving at constant velocity. So calculate coefficient of static friction and calculate coefficient of kinetic friction. And when the chair is about to set in motion, the retarding force is only the static friction force. Let's draw the forces acting on the object. There are four forces acting on this object. One of them is the absolutely gravitational force, which can be calculated by mass times free fall acceleration. Mass is 25, free fall acceleration is 9.8. When we multiply them, it's going to be 245 newtons. And second force is normal force, of course, because this object is in contact, this chair is in contact with the floor. That's why there's the action-reaction forces between the floor and the object. Of course, we will apply a force to move this object, which is applied force F1. If it is still at rest, there must be a static friction force in the opposite direction of tangents of the skidding. Tangents of the skidding is to the right, so static friction force acting on the object must be to the left. Static friction force acting on the object, Fs maximum. Then we are going to use the equation for static friction force for calculating mu s, because we know that Fs max, maximum value of the static friction force, is coefficient of static friction multiplied by normal force. We will continue with this equation. So we will calculate mu s, but first we have to find what is maximum value of the static friction force, and also we should calculate what is Fn. After that, we can easily calculate what mu s is. Let's first get Fs max. Because object, the force acting on the object is initially along the x-axis is equal to zero, so Fx max and Fg F1, some of them must be equal to zero. F1 in positive x direction, it is 165. Fx max is in negative x direction, which is negative Fs max I'm going to write. Sum of them is equal to zero. When I get this negative Fs max to the right side, we will calculate the maximum value of the static friction force must be equal to force which we applied to set into motion, 165 Newton. Then Fn, to calculate Fn, we are going to make that object is, because object is not in it's in equilibrium along in vertical, so sum of the force acting along the y must be equal to zero. Fn is along y axis, so positive Fn. 245 is along negative y, so we are going to write is negative 245. Sum of them must be equal to zero, so Fn is going to be 245 newtons, which is equal to gravitational force. Now we are ready for calculating the mu s, because Fs max is 165. Mu s is the question. Fn is 245. So when we divide 165 by 245, we are going to calculate the coefficient of static friction as 0.67. Let's do the same thing with part B. Find the coefficient of kinetic friction between the chair and the floor. But this time, it is moving with constant velocity. Object is moving with constant velocity. So still the same free body diagram. Fg is downward, which is 245. Fn is upward. And this time, we applied a force less than 165, which is 127. So in positive x direction, we are pulling the object. But this object is moving with constant speed, which means static kinetic friction force must be acting in opposite direction of the velocity. Velocity motion is to the right, kinetic friction force must be to the left. So again, we are going to apply the equation, kinetic friction equation, to calculate mu k. We know that Fk is equal to mu k multiplied by Fn. And because mu k will be calculated, we should first calculate how much is Fk, and we should next calculate how much is Fn. Because object is moving along x-axis with constant velocity, which means it's in equilibrium, net force acting on the object must be equal to zero. So sum of the forces along x-axis must be equal to zero. F2 is in positive x direction, so positive 127, but Fk is in negative x direction, which is negative 127. Negative Fk, sum of them is equal to zero. Then Fk is going to be 127 Newton. Then Fn again will be calculated same way in part A, how we calculate in part A. Sum of the force along y-axis must be equal to zero. So Fn is in positive y direction. Fg is in negative y direction. So negative 245, sum of them is equal to zero because no acceleration in vertical. So Fn is equal to 245. Then use the equation for kinetic friction force. 127 is Fk, mu k is the question, multiply by Fn, which is 245. So then when you divide 127 by 245, you will get the result as 0.52. As you see, coefficient of kinetic friction is less than kinetic coefficient of static friction. So this is what we expected in this problem. Okay, this is all for kinetic and static friction forces. Next lesson, we are going to solve some problems about Newton's laws of motion. See you next lesson.